This is the Smallmouth Crush Podcast. If you're a hardcore angler, you've come to the right place. This is a weekly podcast that will interview some of the top smallmouth bass anglers in North America. Travis and his guest will discuss what it takes to consistently catch big smallmouth, and you'll get a glimpse inside the mind of a trophy smallmouth angler. And now, here's your host of the Smallmouth Crush Podcast, Travis Manson.
Hello and welcome to the Smallmouth Crush Podcast. My name is Travis Manson. Here we go again, talking smallmouth. Why wouldn't we, right? That's what this podcast is all about, talking with some of the top smallmouth bass anglers across the country. And it just seems like there's a lot of good sticks up in Michigan. What is it with Michigan? I don't know. We got another guest from Michigan today, and I'm really, really excited to talk smallmouth fishing with him. Because there's a lot going on up there. You got inland waters, you got big, great lakes. Whether it be Lake Huron, Lake Erie, Lake Michigan, so much going on up there. And a lot of great habitat for smallmouth. So maybe that's why there's so many good smallmouth anglers coming out of the state of Michigan. But before we go there, let's talk about the Real Shot. Of course, the Real Shot's becoming the number one tackle store for Smallmouth Crush fans. They carry everything. Doesn't matter. Mega Bass, Jackal, St. Croix Rods, you name it. Kitech. I mean, the list goes on and on. Dirty Jakes. You guys know the drill by now. They're a supporter of the podcast. And if you head on over to therealshot.com and use my promo code SmallmouthCrush15, you're going to get 15% off your first order. So I would definitely take advantage of that. Head on over and tell them Smallmouth Crush sent you. Let's bring on tonight's guest. Chris, how are you this evening?
Good. How are you doing, Travis?
Man, I'm excited. I'm excited to talk smallmouth fishing. As I kind of alluded to in the beginning, a lot of good sticks come from Michigan. You guys have some amazing smallmouth fishing there. And so I'm going to ask you a bunch of questions, kind of get in your head. What makes you so successful when it comes chasing those brown fish? Because it gets me certainly excited. But before we do that, if you could just give the listeners on all the podcast platforms, as well as the viewers on the YouTube channel, just a little bit of background about yourself and really how you got to where you are today, if you could, Chris.
Roger. Chris Noffsinger. I own Northern Adventures Fishing and Guide Service up here, located out of the Traverse City area in Michigan. Been fortunate. I've been fishing my entire life. Kind of cut my teeth in the salmon and smallmouth world when I was young, 15, 16, 17 years old. I started deckhanding on salmon boats and just kind of kept on fishing and kept on. I grew up actually fishing smallmouth in a river as a kid. Okay. On the Shiawassee River. That's where my love of smallmouth came from. But I got the opportunity to salmon fish and did that. And so I've just been fishing my whole life and did a little tour in the Army and enjoyed that. And then and now I came back to fishing, and that's where I'm at today. I'm still fishing. Been fortunate enough to make guiding a living or make a living guiding. So and that's I'm doing what I love, man. I've always said I was going to hunt or fish for a living since I was a little kid. And here we are.
Right. So, right.
Still doing it. And this will be my 30th season or 31st season of charter fishing this year.
Wow.
So,
wow.
Yeah, a lot of fun.
Well, thank you for your service. So the, what was that river you grew up? I can't.
It's called the Shiawassee River.
Okay.
It empties into Saginaw Bay eventually. So it's in that whole chain right there that ends up going into Saginaw Bay.
How's the fishing there nowadays in that river?
That river is amazing for smallmouth fishing. It's so much fun. We used to float it in a canoe actually, or we would just wade it. I mean, as a kid, I did more wade fishing probably than anything. Mm-hmm. And literally have my parents drop me off or a buddy drop me off 3 or 4 or 5 miles upstream and just walk all the way down to the house. We had property on the river. Mm-hmm. So, or I'd walk from the house all the way down and swim through the deep holes and just keep your rod above the water,
Right.
You find all the little logs and you learn a lot about smallmouth, especially current smallmouth when you fish a river your whole life. So it's a little bit different, obviously, than fishing the St. Clair River or the Detroit River, but there's a lot of similarities just on a grander scale.
Sure. So, I was going to say that, it seems like, especially for the listeners and viewers that maybe have just started getting into smallmouth fishing or want to, that's a really good starting point because there's so many little streams and rivers across the country. You know, I grew up in Wisconsin and growing up, there was a lot of opportunities to, for people that don't have boats and don't have access, you know, to some of the great fishing that's found oftentimes way offshore. There is a tremendous of opportunity. And sometimes, you know, you got to put a little work in as far as maybe away from the crowd and, you know, the effort it takes to wade up these streams or, you know, I mean, just probably like you back in the day, it was a pair of old tennis shoes and shorts and just going to town. You know, how has that evolved and, you know, as far as making you a good smallmouth fisherman? You mentioned a little bit about reading the current and things like that, but you know, some of your earlier memories, what were some of the baits and stuff that you would throw? And has that stayed the same today?
No, it's evolved so much. I mean, when I was a kid, I did actually a lot of fly fishing, with just a little bumblebee popper. You know, I used to love those things. You catch rock bass on them, catch smallmouth on them. And then the old three hook plow jockey, you know, rubber worm. Those were always a favorite on the river, or the little two hookers. And then we live baited them too, man. We fished a lot of, you know, crawlers in the current, you know, just hook a crawler and let him go, you know, drift him right down through a hole or something like that. It just, you learn how to read where smallmouth hold, you know, when they're in the eddies, or, you know, where do they hold when a log's laying at an angle? Is the log facing upriver? Is it facing down current? You know, where are they on gravel? Are they on sand? You know, you run into weed patches in the river and you see how fish relate to weed patches in a river too. They relate to it very similarly anywhere there's current. So,
right. Yeah.
I mean, it's just a lot of little things like that that you pick up as a kid. I mean, literally I was probably 5-6 years old when I started going down to the river and fishing. And then I would start wading probably when I was 10, when my dad finally trusted me enough to wade, and then, you know, just kept on going from there.
So you probably caught a 5-pounder before you had your driver's license, huh?
No, I honestly didn't. So my grandparents lived in Frankfort, Michigan, and that's where I kept coming up to every summer. And then obviously northern Michigan here around the Traverse City area is loaded with smallmouth opportunities. And I would fish all these small little inland lakes in a little rowboat or, you know, a little 9-9 kicker, you know, in a canoe. You know, those were the things that we did. And that's when I really started to evolve and understand the fishery up here. But it all started, you know, down there. So,
right.
My love for smallmouth has been here for a long time.
What do you consider your, I guess, home body of water, or, you know, the place you normally fish the most right now?
You know, I hate saying a home body of water, but I fish a region. I mean, obviously, Northwest Michigan is a region I fish 99%. There's so many bodies of water here, man. I mean, so many. You've got little itty bitty inland lakes to medium to big to the Great Lakes and Grand Traverse Bay. I mean, I think most people believe I fish on Grand Traverse Bay the most. I probably do spend the most time out there, but I spend a lot of time, especially on our inland lakes, for sure.
Wow. So there's a lot I have to ask about this because it always fascinated me. You know, growing up in Wisconsin, we have a lot of inland lakes as well that are just loaded with big smallmouth, you know, small inland lakes that don't look like much, but have a really good population. And then, of course, you know, Bay of Green Bay, Lake Michigan for you would be very similar. You know, the Great Lakes right there, as well as the inland lakes. Do you experience that same situation where there's some giant fish in those inland lakes just as well as the bigger lakes?
Oh, absolutely. I actually think some of the better lakes where I catch some of my bigger fish, honestly, are the smaller inland lakes. It's not necessarily Grand Traverse Bay anymore. There was a time when that happened, but that's really kind of the bigger fish have not been caught there the last few years. So my bigger fish have all come from inland bodies of water. The bays actually open up first, but it's really ice cold. I mean, I'll try it a couple times. You can catch them, but it's difficult. I usually try to stay the inland lakes first. I really like our inland lakes. I mean, that they're in their wintering holes and you can literally sit in one spot and catch 30, 40, 50 in a row and never unlock your spot lock, you know, lock the motor guide down, boom, she sits right there and you just stay there and catch fish after fish, after fish, after fish. So that's what I like to do.
As far as the Great Lakes, besides Lake Superior, I got to assume that that region's probably the least explored just because there's not as many big bass tournaments, you know, national events that happen there. There's so much water that it seems like you could probably get away. I mean, is there times where you don't see another bass boat out there, or is it pretty popular? And I'm wrong.
I spend more time on the Michigan side. And it used to be that way. I mean, it used to be you could go a week and never see a bass boat. Mm-hmm. If I go over the Huron side, there's still a lot less pressure over there. The pressure on that side's way less than what it is on the west side now.
Oh, okay.
So, yeah, the east side is a lot less pressure. The west side, the Michigan side, there's a lot more pressure here now. So you don't go weeks. You're lucky if you go an hour without seeing a boat now.
Gotcha.
So that's all. Now, if you explore out onto, say, Lake Michigan proper and you get out of the bays, then, yeah, it's a lot different. But, you know, the entire shoreline, you know, pretty much from, oh, gosh, Waukeshaunce on down is pretty well explored. I mean, there's still quite a few guys that are starting to hit that now and figuring it out and piece by piece, putting it together.
Yeah, that whole region, just like I said, fascinates me. I mean, getting even further up, and it's weird. You look at a map and you think, oh, that's not too bad of a boat ride. I mean, I fished Washington Island and you know, my thoughts were always, man, I'd love to just scoot on over, you know, 60 miles and hit up in that region. There's got to be some big fish, but it just looks really appealing when you look at a map, all the different structure that's available for you and, you know, areas where those fish will congregate. What's your favorite way to fish for smallmouth? Like if you could pick one style, are you a shallow guy, a deep guy?
My favorite thing, hands down, is top water fishing. I'm guilty to it to a point of bad. I'm addicted to it. But deep fishing them deep is probably my best strength, but I just absolutely love the top water bite. It's
okay.
Hands down, my favorite thing, favorite way to catch smallmouth.
So is this Lake Michigan, Lake Huron, or inland lakes? Or both?
Inland lakes. Okay. You can catch a few of them. You know, you get on, there's times you get on a fairly decent topwater bite on the big water, but for the most part, it's an inland lake deal. For me anyways.
I was hoping you were going to say, you know, Lake Michigan and places like that, because I struggle. I love throwing topwater, but I rarely have like a solid pattern that I can say, okay, I'm going to head up on Lake Michigan or Lake Ontario or even Lake Erie and catch them on top. It just doesn't happen for me as often as I would hope. And so I was hoping you were going to say, yeah, we crush them out there. And then I would be like, oh, but so inland lakes, top water, is it more walking baits? Is it pop-ars or, you know, what's your kind of technique when you're targeting those? And then what time of year is it mainly summer or is it throughout the whole season?
It's pretty much from post spawn on through, you know, the fall. Obviously the fall topwater bite is amazing. That good post spawn bite is really good. Right after that fry hatches in their garden fry. That's a lot of fun to get out there and splash around. You know, and I use a lot of different topwater baits. I let the fish tell me. I mean, I've always got a pop R tied on of some sort, popping bait. I've always got a prop bait of some sort tied on. One of my favorite all time is a little head and tiny torpedo. You know, I've used one of those forever. Obviously now the whopper plopper's the rage. That thing's been out for a while. And then obviously spooks, walking baits, stuff like that. You can't go wrong. I like to have an arrangement because sometimes I found, you know, they don't want a popping bait. They want something that is moving. So you really kind of got to let them, or they want a certain cadence with a prop bait, you know, where you just got to either speed it up or speed it up, slow it down, speed it up, slow it down, or it's just a constant retrieve. Every day the fish are different, I think. And it's trying to figure that out. So always having a bunch ready to go.
So you mentioned torpedo. That's a small bait. When you get into the whopper ploppers and spooks, do you mess around with different sizes or do you have one that you see is a little bit more consistent as far as the action?
The big one knocker, man. The big Zaraspook one knocker. Mm. Yeah. Bone color. If I had to pick one that I would take out of all the walking baits, it would be the one knocker spook. Yep.
So two hooks on that, correct?
Yeah.
On that one knocker? Okay.
Yep, two hooks.
Gotcha. And then how about the plopper? Because they come in a lot of different sizes. You know, I like that 90 size. Am I missing the boat or should I be going a little bit bigger?
Well, I got some friends up here that fish muskie, and they always seem to catch big smallmouth on muskie baits every year. So I've never been afraid to throw the big one, you know, that 130. Mm. And I throw the 90 a lot, but I throw the 130 as well. And we catch some tanks on it. I mean, it's, you're not going to get the number of bites that you get on the smaller ones, but the ones you catch are magnums usually. Sure.
One of the most memorable topwater bites I've ever experienced was back in Wisconsin around middle of May. There was a variety, there was some fish on bed still. I can't tell you exactly what was going on. There was some type of insect hatch, but I don't think it was mayflies. I'm actually not sure what was going on that day, but they were slurping these bugs off of the surface. And I threw a little, I think it was some type of savage. I wouldn't even remember the name of the prop bait, but it was one hook and it had one prop on the back, and it was only about 2 inches long. And I threw that out there and basically just, you know, burped it back to the boat. At that time, I mean, what I experienced that day was pretty unreal. Never had a day like that again with that bait, actually. I don't think I even caught a fish on that since. But that time of year, it was just, for me, that water temp was still in the mid-50s. It was just a shocker to me. Is that a crazy, like, wow, I can't believe that happened? Or is that a common theme for you as well that time of year?
I wouldn't say it's common, but it's definitely happened. I mean, I've caught them early in the year, you know, 52, 53 degrees on top water. It's not something I commonly do, you know. Usually then I'm throwing a jerk bait, mm-hmm. you know. So I usually wait till the water gets up there into the mid-60s, you know, 63, 64. That's where I like it. I like it when it's on that cool down. You can catch them obviously all summer long on top water. I mean, you fish New York, you know, I mean, that bite over there on Champlain and on Oneida can be ridiculous.
What's your typical setup when you're throwing these top waters? Are you a braid guy? Are you throwing mono? Or does it depend on the bait?
It really depends on the bait. So I throw braid on pretty much anything that I walk, or my prop style baits, the whopper ploppers. But like for my little tiny torpedo or my poppers, I'm a braid to a mono leader. I really like to have about a 18 to 24 inch mono leader. That's just my personal setup. I think you get a little better pop out of it. The braid doesn't get wrapped around the hooks as much. You know, I mean, when you just use a straight braid, and I use light braid, I'm using a 15 pound no fade braid, and it's literally, it gets wrapped around the hooks if you don't have that piece of mono in there. So mm-hmm. it's kind of nice to have, keeps that from happening.
So let's talk a little bit about, you mentioned the deep bite, which I assume happens sometime in that July on type of scenario when those fish do go deep. What are you doing to locate these fish? Like, what's your most important thing that you look at? Is it hours behind the wheel idling, or is it map study, specific areas that you're looking for in the lake when they're going to go deep? Like, how would you break down, say, a new body of water or someone that's trying to, you know, experience that deep bite that we keep hearing about? Because obviously, you know, a lot of times those fish do go deep in the summer, depending on the thermocline. And I imagine you might have that set up on some of your inland lakes too. I could be wrong. I'm not as familiar with that. Walk me through that kind of setup.
Yeah. So if I'm going somewhere new, like, I mean, I remember back the first time I went to Oneida, you know, first thing I did is I picked up a map of the lake and I tried to identify what I thought would be spawning flats, you know, and then I tried to identify post spawn areas. And then from there, I tried to find the deepest good structure I could find, mm-hmm. you know, anywhere from. And when I say deep, it's relative to the body of water. Mm-hmm. You know, some lakes deep fishing is 50, 60 foot, where in some lakes deep fishing is 15 to 25 feet. So you got to take that into account as well. But just trying to find those secondary areas after the post spawn, you know, like outside of those spawning flats, the second and third break, you know, off of that, if you can find that, that's what I start with and look for. And then it's a lot of time behind the wheel, you know, side imaging. Looking for those rock piles, looking up here, we have a lot of, submerged logs from the logging days. So that's kind of old school. You know, there's a lot of logs in these lakes. I mean, they're 8 foot long, every single one of them. And they're as big around as I am, or sometimes two or three times the size of me, round. And they're on the bottom all over up here because they sunk as they were floating them to the mills. And those actually get growth on them. And that's bait fish hang around that, crayfish hang around it. So those sunken logs are a lot of what I catch a lot of deep fish on, not only on the Great Lakes, but on the inland lakes as well. Cool. So that's kind of a way I break that down.
The old logging pattern.
Yeah, it's a thing up here, man. I've got literally logs from 4 foot all the way out to 50 foot, mm-hmm. That are literally giant logs that you can go out there, you can drop shot them. You can drop a hair jig on them early in the year sometimes. It just depends. I actually have an ice shanty that I've got that sunk out there that I've caught a bunch of fish on that, early in the season. They just seem to be around it. So
what other structure? I mean, do those lakes have a lot of rock as well? What's the bottom kind of content like there?
Yeah. So, this is a loaded question because we've got a lot of different lakes up here. Styles of lakes. Like we have the Great Lakes, which have rock and sand. That's basically what the Great Lakes are, along with the bays. And then we get into some of our other lakes that are more just all gravelly and rock. And there's not a whole lot of marl, as you would say, or sand. It's just a lot of gravel. Mm-hmm. Then you have a mix. And then you have lakes that are just basically a soft marl bottom with, a few patches of reeds up shallow. Up tight with maybe a couple of gravel bars here and there. So there's a lot of different styles of lakes that we have here too, and they warm at different rates. So, you can literally fish pre-spawn here from ice out till July 1st
or
first, second week of July with the Great Lakes because the water's cold and you get to fish all those different styles of lakes. And it's so cool because I can get a pre-spawn bite the last week of June and go later in the day and fish topwater bite on an inland lake that's all post-spawn.
Man.
So it's really diverse. It's really cool.
How many inland lakes do you have in your general vicinity that hold smallmouth? I mean, hundreds, thousands? Is it?
Not thousands. I would say, an honest number from here, just off the top of my head, it's probably somewhere 50 to 75 lakes that I can be at within an hour and a half to 2 hours. Mm. 20 that I can be at within 45 minutes. So there's a lot of, I'll never fish all the water there is to fish here in my lifetime. It just won't happen.
Right. Well, when you were talking about the deep fish, when you're finding them and you're looking, let's say you have a bunch of logs located and you're kind of working that pattern. Are you idling over looking for fish on the graph and then fishing for them? And then what techniques are you utilizing to catch them?
I do now. I used to fish every one, but now that electronics have evolved, I did a lot of graphing now because you can drive over those logs, and with the electronics we have, you can pick the fish right out of the weeds or off the logs. You can see them, so you can see whether it's worth fishing or not. A lot of times you can see the logs up here in the shallower stuff, to 10 foot deep. So I don't drive over those ones. Mm-hmm. The deeper logs I'll drive over, the shallower ones I'll stay back, cast them both sides up, down, spin around, make a different angle at it, fish it, and then move on. Smallmouth, they're pretty aggressive. They're going to bite.
Sure, sure.
They're going to bite. So.
Do you find a technique over a certain one more to your liking or your style? I assume you're doing a lot of drop shotting, probably tubes and Ned rigs. Am I correct on that?
Yeah, no, there's definitely a lot of that. When they get sucked up to those logs, I like chucking a spinnerbait, man. If they're not, a lot of times they'll come up off of it and they might miss your spinnerbait, but they're there. And then you follow up with a drop shot, a tube, or a Ned rig. Just get them to show themselves. As soon as they show themselves, then you're in the game. If they're there.
Are most of those bodies of water that you're talking about on the inland side clear, or is there some bracket, not brackish, but I guess more tannic, I would say? Like I'm just thinking back in Wisconsin, we have a variety of different lakes that some are crystal clear and some are more of a flowage where it's a little darker stain to that body of water. Or are you pretty much clear water?
I would say it's similar. The majority of our lakes I would say are really clear though. Mm-hmm. You've got 10 to 25, 30 foot of visibility in a lot of our inland lakes. The bays early first thing in the season, I can see 65 foot. I can see the bottom.
Wow.
So, that's crystal clear, but yeah, we have definitely some darker stained tannic waters, but that's where good sunglasses come into play. So, you're taking that glare off and you can actually see those little bit darker spots in that darker water, to see that's key.
Walk us through your bait selection. And I guess, first off, what are these inland lake smallmouth generally feeding on?
Up here we've got a few different forages. Perch, smelt, and crayfish, I would say, are their main forages in our inland lakes. But now some of our inland lakes have got some gobies in them as well. So gobies, obviously, on the Great Lakes and Grand Traverse Bay are right up there on the food chain. But and then we also have emerald shiners. You know, those are a big thing. Mm-hmm. But the smelt, the perch, the crayfish, those are your main forages for them.
Mm-hmm. What would you say your biggest strength is when it comes to smallmouth fishing? Is it a technique or is it how you locate them? What kind of makes you so successful at being able to stay on top of these fish on such a regular and consistent basis?
It's time on the water, man.
Is it? Yeah.
Yeah. It's really time on the water because fortunately guiding, I mean, you're on the water every day. I mean, you're staying with it. You're seeing the changes that happen. And over time, now that I've fished them for as long as I have, you learn this just kind of becomes second nature. I used to have notebooks full of all my little notes and everything. And unfortunately it got stolen. Storage unit got broke into. I lost a whole tote of my fishing notes and fishing stuff. So if somebody's got that out there, they've got a wealth of information of old school. That right there is just time on the water, man. Mm-hmm. And seeing what's going on. I'm sure you've seen Zona and all those guys up here that do the shows, and a popular thing up here is lake hopping. So reason we do that is, at least I feel the reason I do it is, you know, you see what's going on this lake and you see what the temperature is. Well, it might not be going there, but you know, this other lake is usually 3 degrees warmer or colder, and you know, it should be a lot better. Or, you know, you keep going until you find a good solid bite. And having so many lakes close together, it's nice because you can literally go power fish, find them or not find them, and move to the next. Rather than moving spot to spot on a lake, you're moving lake to lake. So it's
crazy. Yeah.
It's fun.
Man. Yeah. Sign me up for that. That would be fun, man. Speaking of those logbooks that you wrote down, what are the things that you're kind of recording or taking note when you are out there to kind of help you, you know, for the future? What are some key things that you look for that you want to remember?
Yeah, it's kind of a combination of everything. Now, with the Lowrances, in a lot of the units out there, but you can just put your notes right in on your waypoint, which is kind of nice. So I'll go back in, I'll hit a waypoint, and I'll go back through the notes, and that's where I keep, you know, my logbook now. And I'll put on there, you know, hey, is it sunny? How many feet of water were we in? You know, wind, was it a west wind, north wind, south wind, east wind? Moon phase is really important. Mm-hmm. That's one thing I pay attention to a lot. Just the basic weather conditions.
Talking about moon phase, I feel it has definitely a difference during the spawn, but let's take ourselves away from the spawn. Let's say we're out there in August. What's going to be kind of a telltale sign as far as what the moon is, what phase it's in and what it's doing, that's going to dictate how you fish that day? Or maybe is it you just increase a fish activity that you've noticed? Or can you give me an example of that?
I can tell you, from my experience, I don't know, for the most part, anything past a full moon or a new moon, you know, when you're 2 to 5 days past a full or a new moon, the bite is usually pretty tough. Okay. There are days that are, you can catch them, but as a general sum over time, those have been my toughest days to catch fish. So, but the days leading up to it are usually the best. You know, that's just something I've noticed over the years, for me personally anyways.
So these inland lakes, how would you describe the ideal conditions? If you could pick your perfect day and to go out there, what type of conditions are you going to look for or hope for, I guess?
Each month is different. So I'll start in September because September, they're really starting to get on that spinnerbait bite. They're coming back up shallow, and I like to throw a spinnerbait. You know, a nice 6 to 12 inch chop on the water, nice breeze. Sunny day where they're up shallow, because smallmouth, you know, if it's sunny, they're coming shallow. Mm-hmm. And just covering water, that's what I like. I mean, just a good, nice, steady breeze blowing in, and that's my ideal recipe, you know, my favorite. Now for the top water bite, I want it calm first thing in the morning would be great. You know, give me a solid 2 hours of calm, nice, clear, flat water. You know, maybe a little overcast in the morning for that. Because once that sun comes up, you can still actually catch them here all day long. There's a few lakes up here where if it's flat, calm, you'll catch them all day long in the fall. It's ridiculous. It's a lot of fun. Mm-hmm. So
that's interesting, because I love throwing a spinner bait. Who doesn't? Do you mess around with colors? Are you pretty, are you one of those guys that like the the chartreuse blades or just, you know, silver, or what's your perfect spinnerbait or, spinnerbait that you throw quite a bit that time of year?
There's two different types of spinnerbaits I throw, and they're just for me. I throw a Red Dirt spinnerbait by Red Dirt Bait Company and a Strike King burner. Those are the two with the smaller blades. The burner has the smaller blades, and then the Red Dirt has the bigger blades. I do chartreuse and white with the chartreuse and white skirt, all chartreuse, and an emerald shiner, nickel and white blades. I keep it simple.
That covers everything. Yeah, if you had to ask me the same thing, that pretty much you have your bases covered as far as what you're going to encounter, with those color spinner baits. Do you find a type of bite when you're burning that spinner bait versus when you have to slow it down a little bit, covering water quickly with a spinner bait normally?
Yeah, there's times where they like it down a little bit in the water column, keep it about a foot below the surface and let it roll. Mm-hmm. So, and not only that, when they light that thing up on the other end, it feels like your wrist is going to get broke. So
sure. Trailer hook or no?
When I'm tournament fishing, yeah. If I'm just fun fishing, no.
You have things dialed in up there. Let's talk a little bit about some of the, the Lake Michigan side, the bays there. Walk me through like a typical spring to fall patterns that you encounter out there, if you could. Let's start with the spring.
Yeah. So, as soon as the ice comes off, the fish are in their wintering holes and they're still pretty deep. You can actually still find them 60, 70 foot deep out there, early when the ice comes off. And then they'll gradually move up. They'll come up onto the flats as the flats warm. Then you're chasing warm water. Where's the warmest water? You got to chase the warm water. And then they move into their spawning phase. So now they're up on the flats, the gravel, the clay ridges. That's where they're at. They're spawning out there. And then as they start to move post-spawn, they scatter out. So you're going from big groups of fish to pairs of fish. And then they start coming back into groups, three, four, five at a time. Then it's 15, 20 at a time. Then it's, back to the big groups in the fall of 30 to 60, 70, 80, 100 fish at a time. Mm-hmm. So, and there's always fish shallow on the Great Lakes, always. Yeah. There, no matter what, you're going to find them, in 5 to 15 foot of water, somewhere in there. But there's also a big group of fish that is 15 to 70 foot of water as well. That's really it. If I'm not seeing them deep, then I move shallow. If I'm not finding anything shallow, then I move deep. And if they're not in there, then I go in between.
Late fall, talk to me about that. Are you, I'm a big blade bait guy. Do you get to experience that bite a little bit?
All the seminars I've done, I will tell you the number one bait for me, hands down. I've caught more 7-pounders on a blade bait than any other bait.
So, walk me through the different blade baits that you do utilize, because there's so many out there. I have a hard time picking one because there's, there's $25 Japanese blade baits and there's, $4 Bass Pro Shop blade baits. How do you pick the perfect blade bait?
I fish all of them. I literally fish all the ones you mentioned, the Jackals, the Mega Bass, the Blitz Blades, the original Silver Buddy. I kind of let the fish tell me. Sometimes they want a really small blade bait. When they want that small profile, the Jackal or that Mega Bass are the best ones that I found. And sometimes they want a wider wobble to that thing. And that's when I go to a Blitz Blade. And then the in-between is a Silver Buddy. But it's hard to beat the original Silver Buddy. Probably throw that more than any of them. I don't get real crazy into colors with them.
Okay.
You can. Silver and gold. I do some of the bluegill patterns. That's probably one of my favorite ones. And the other two, something that, it's got that little gill or perch look to it. But that's really it, man. In the weight depends on how deep I'm fishing. 3/4, 1/2 quarter, so obviously heavier, deeper. The rare occasion of that is, and I'm giving this one out, on the bay, early in the season when it's really cold water and those fish are really skittish, I'll actually put on a really heavy blade bait and I'll chuck it a mile and then I'll work it back in shallow water. And that has been really productive for me at finding some really quality fish.
So heavy meaning what size? You over a half
quarter.
Three quarter.
Oh yeah.
Wow. Okay. Are you throwing that on the bait caster or a spinning setup?
the heavier ones I'm throwing on a bait caster. So I throw both. I do a spinning rod and a bait caster. I've actually really preferred throwing them on a bait caster the last few years, just my own personal preference. Mm-hmm. But
yeah,
a lot of my buddies throw them on a spinning rod.
Sure. I'm a little bit of both myself. There's something about a bite on a blade bait with a bait caster, you know, when you just give that little vibration out there and then stops and then you can just wail on them. You know what I mean? Is that your typical retrieve? Is it pretty standard or do you switch the retrieve up as well?
No, man, this is one thing that I've given this out in my seminars too, but it takes a little bit of getting used to, and it's teaching clients to do it. I really think the key thing with the blade bait for me, especially the bigger fish, is to not give the blade bait too much action. I see a lot of guys that like to burp it really high, you know, 2, 3, 4 foot off the bottom. And for me, that's not the case. I like a little brrr, like literally, I don't want to move that bait more than 12 inches off the bottom. 18 inches is like the max. I want to keep that thing right on the bottom, you know, little burps, short brrr, brrr, brrr. You know, that's how I want that bait to be presented. Mm-hmm. So, and just getting the feel of when you hit the bottom, you watch your line. I mean, my line is actually like my bobber. So I'm watching my line the whole time. And as soon as that slack goes in my line, one of two things has happened. If I didn't feel a thump, a fish picked it up where it's on the bottom. So mm-hmm. I'm going to go to lift it again right then. So it's just a little trick that I've done with them. And it's been really successful for some nice fish.
What size line are you throwing blade baits on typically?
12-pound Pro Elite fluorocarbon.
Yeah,
that's what I throw it on. I love that line for that bait.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I definitely agree. I think that's the perfect size line. You know, I've used heavier, I've used lighter. I don't think there's a need to go lighter at all. And you know yourself, especially in the Great Lakes and stuff, some of that bottom's pretty funky with zebra mussels and things like that. And I think that
we got a lot of those.
that 12 is perfect, man. What's your biggest, you see talking 7-pounders. What's your personal best smallmouth?
Man, I don't have a weight on it, to be honest with you.
Oh yeah.
The biggest one I've ever put on a scale was 7-10 myself personally. The biggest I've had a client put on the scale is 7-12. Those are the biggest confirmed weight. I'll tell you that the one that I caught, I've got a picture of it. I show it in seminars, but it's somewhere between 8.8 and 9.8 would be my guess. So.
Wow. What did you catch that on? What time of year?
That was actually an August fish.
Whoa.
Yep. And it was on a drop shot. I'm going to guess it was a poor boy's goby. Probably, like a goby junior.
Uh-huh.
Really goby juniors or a darter. One of the two.
Sure.
I still fish those. A lot of my drop shot stuff now is more along the lines of the dream shots. I really like those. I like the jackal crosstail shads, the shad shaped worms. Those are the main things I'm fishing now on a drop shot. Mm-hmm. So,
yeah. I can't argue with that setup, man. That's a big fish. There's obviously some giants up that way. Man, I would love to experience up there. Someday I'll get up in that zone and I'll have to look you up. Speaking of that, if somebody's interested in going out with you, what's the best way to follow you on, you know, whether it be social media or just get a hold of you to book a trip?
My website, northernadventuresfishing.com. I'm on Facebook there as well, Northern Adventures Fishing. It's at Fishing for a Living on Instagram. So that's where we're at. You can look me up there. Call me, email me. Everything is on the website. It's on the Facebook page. A lot of opportunities for the smallmouth of a lifetime or several smallmouth.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I know this is the last question. It's going to be a little, I guess, make believe here because it's not ever going to happen. But if I was to tell you how to throw one bait the rest of your life for smallmouth all season long, like this is the only bait you get, what are you going to go for?
That's easy. It's a tube.
A tube. Sure.
Yeah. I mean, there's, man, I everywhere I've gone in the country and fished these things, you catch them on a tube, you know, and there it's, whether it's a smaller gets it style or, you know, or it's a bigger fat, big old Strike King donker tubes, you know, whatever you're looking for, mm-hmm. they will eat a tube. And, mm-hmm. and for a smallmouth, I think that's probably the number one bait all around. Smallmouth bait for sure.
All right, let's take it one step further. Color.
Green pumpkin.
Green pumpkin.
Yeah, I mean, the older I get and the more I do this, I've learned that a lot of baits are out there to catch anglers.
Sure.
So, yeah. But which is a good thing, but man, I really try to simplify it. So, and there's times where, yeah, I've got a whole arsenal in a bunch of different colors. You know, you got your watermelons and, you know, which is just a different shade of green pumpkin, you know, sometimes white tube though is the deal. And then honestly, a hot pink tube sometimes is the deal. So I really like a bright pink tube. And then, you know, up here, we also, because it's so visual, the siren tube there from Strike King, that chartreuse one, is you can really see it. You can watch it disappear. So you really see the bite with it. So it's good to have colors. It's good to have a variance. But man, if you were to tell me I had one bait I had to fish with the rest of my life, it'd be a green pumpkin tube.
Man, good information. This is like a crash course for me. And I'm sure a lot of people that are looking at, you know, fishing for smallmouth in the different regions. It's so fascinating. It sounds like you got a lot going on up in that zone. And man, good stuff, man. I really appreciate Chris coming on tonight. And again, if anyone's interested in hooking up, watching getting a guide trip with you, all that information will be in the show notes as well.
Hey, I appreciate having me. Thank you. You got some awesome people on here. So
yeah, definitely.
Good stuff.
Awesome. All right, guys. Well, thanks for checking out the podcast this week. And as always, until next time, we'll see you guys on the water.
Thanks so much for listening today. Make sure that you're subscribed to the show and follow us on Instagram at Smallmouth Crush. Also, the YouTube channel, Smallmouth Crush. And if you feel so inclined, please leave us a 5-star rating and comment with a review below. And as always, until next time, we'll see you on the water.